The best time to write is...
Now.
The best place to write is...
Here.
The best person to write is...
You.
Thank you, everyone, for showing up to take the night off by writing nights in the lovely, the local auditorium. Woo! I will open tonight with a response to the question, why do I write? I wish it was as noble as I write because I'm compelled to, or I write because I couldn't imagine myself doing something else. I mean, it isn't like I'm being forced into writing, but it feels like I'm destined to do this. Every other path has been blocked. All of my energy that I've tried to focus elsewhere is blocked and diminished. This feels like the fate's way of saying, you are a writer. Someone, something above or around or behind or beneath needs me to be a writer, and I have only ever been good at one other thing, and that thing I can't make money from. So I'm trying to use this power of writing for the good of humankind somehow. So I publish, I explore, I advance, I perpetuate positive, negative, neutral energies. I strive for balance with myself and encourage other people. Creative passions, and I write. We have a great night of performers. I'm not gonna say much else because I don't have any more of the flyers left to properly introduce this person. So please welcome Molly Fuller.
Hello.
Good.
Hi, Molly.
Hello.
So I'm going to read from my new book that's coming out very soon.
Yeah. Yeah, it is.
New book?
Until then, what is it doing?
It's, you know, hanging out. I'm right here. It's right here. And then it's going to fly away and become a real book. So this first piece is called Blackbirds. Don't eat those, they said. But I was difficult, obstinate, always did the opposite of what they said. I took handfuls of the bright red berries. I put them in my mouth, smeared the juice across my lips, staining my teeth, my hands. Later, I watched birds eating them, flocking to them, not even pausing to rest as they stripped the bush of the crimson fruit.
Woo.
This is a little piece. It's called A Story About Ophelia. Her hair is wet. It will not dry. She twists the strands around and around in her palms, but the hair keeps stretching, like fishing line, like taffy. She stands knee-deep in the water, her feet covered in silt. She bends toward her toes, the better to see them, but she only succeeds in getting the tip of her nose wet. She laughs. This laughter is a lovely sound. We all run to hear it. We want to join her. But what if we all get tangled in hair? What if she were to drown? I think I'm going to read a little longer piece next. This is a little flash fiction, and it is called How to Date a Doctor. So, how to date a doctor. Go for a jog around the crappy man-made lake next to your apartment complex because you want to look good in a bikini this summer. Decide to run the final lap barefoot, because even though the sand is hauled in from who knows where, it still feels good between your toes. Feel pain in your foot. Look down and see glass in your heel, probably because some asshole kids buried their empties. Wonder if you should pull the glass out or hobble home one-footed. Decide that you have to get the glass out in order to go anywhere. Take a deep breath and feel the slippery, jagged thing with your fingers. Without really looking, do something you never dreamed you could do. Now, go to the emergency room. Have an old towel, one you got as a wedding present and don't give a shit about anymore, to soak up the blood. Dig the nails of your left hand into the fleshy part of your right palm to distract yourself from the pain. Look around the emergency waiting area. Don't look too long at the man with the bloody ace bandage wrapped around his head. Don't sigh loudly every minute like the woman next to you. It won't make them call your number faster. Try to ignore the glassy-eyed babies sitting on their mother's laps who aren't even making noise anymore. When they do call you, raise your hand so that the nurse with the clipboard can come over and push your hospital-issued wheelchair into a second place to wait. Take the proffered hand that helps you limp from rolling chair into sitting position on the hospital bed behind a curtain, which the nurse pulls tightly closed before taking your blood pressure. Nod like you know what it means as he says the number out loud. When he asks why you are here, unwrap the towel and feel sick, but fascinated, while you both stare at the pieces of uneven skin surrounding the oozing cut. Put the towel back and wait for the doctor to see you. Try to think about anything else. Try to recite a poem in your head, any poem. Forget it by the second stanza. When the doctor comes in, let yourself be distracted by her long, shiny ponytail. Tell yourself you will not imagine her naked, but then go ahead, because at least you're not thinking about how she is cleaning the area around what looks like the inside of a red jelly bean with cold, liquid-soaked cotton. Wonder if she likes women. Try to think about something you can ask to test this theory out. Think about this harder as she removes a syringe from a drawer and starts to fill it from a vial. Make some kind of strange guttural sound you've never heard yourself make as she presses the needle into the foot. Allow yourself to wonder what kind of underwear she wears as she sews up your wound, then feel badly for objectifying her. Say something that you immediately regret about her being good at stitches. Ask how long before you can wear high heels. Try to say something innocuous that you can blame on feeling woozy, but then end up blurting out that the two of you should move out of this Midwestern town and go someplace where you can get married. Worry for a second that you are completely wrong. Feel relieved when she laughs. Enjoy the sound of her laughter. Wonder if you should invite her for coffee. Don't look away when she looks up and into your eyes. Feel disappointed when she tells you that her girlfriend might not like that. Feel like high-fiving yourself because your gaydar is still so good after months and months of not using it. Watch her wrap clean, white gauze around your foot. Dig around in your purse. Act like you are looking for something, like a business card, which you don't have because you are a writer and don't really need one. Look up when she hands you a prescription. Glance at what she has written on it. See that it is a phone number. Okay. Should we get a little dark?
Go for it.
Two boys ride their bikes through the rose garden to the fountain inside the square. Identical hands dip under clear water, pushing through their reflections to grab up fistfuls of change. Pennies are pitched off the bridge onto the highway, the silver saved for something special. After they run out of pennies, the perfect rock is discovered, half buried in the dirt. Prying it loose from the earth, they bloody their fingers. She is driving the black sedan, knuckles clenched on 10 and 2. This is her first time manning her husband's car. It takes both boys to carry the rock to the edge. They lift it over the railing, watch it land on her windshield below. Her sharp breath fills her ears as glass splinters into a spider's web. She can't see. She can't feel her feet on the pedals, her hands on the wheel. Her car coasts to the side of the road. Down the hill they scamper. A noon sun beats on their blonde heads as they carry her into the nearby field. They prospect her like a pocket watch, learning how women work. Tall stalks of grass bruise under their weight. Then they put her back together, button up her secretary's blouse, zip her into the long skirt, put her sensible heels on her left foot, and then her right. Brushing the dirt away from her still face, they place the quarters over the rouge on her cheeks, shiny mirrors beneath her open eyes.
Yeah, go for it.
Okay, I don't know that I've ever read this one the whole way through. This is actually the title piece of the book. So this is called Girls Forged by Lightning. One. We learned about the boys early on. Back when we wore plaid skirts that had to touch the floor as we knelt, our exposed knees against the polished stone floor. The kind of floor that looks like thousands of pebbles pressed down and down until it gleams in rows of smooth squares that we could spend the hour in detention counting and then count again. We ironed our white blouses, pulled up our knee socks, shined our saddle shoes. The only thing that belonged to us was under our skirts. Black bikini briefs, patterned pink panties trimmed in lace, polka-dotted silk, all the colors of the rainbow, the boys always wanting to see. Passing by, us giggling in the hallways, our ponytails bouncing out behind in waves of black, blonde, brown, red. They would whisper, "Show us." We shook our heads, we turned our faces. They came for us on the playground, behind the bleachers, around the edge of the school square, red brick building. Behind the Oxford shirted line, they formed of themselves. We tried to stick together. We stood shoulder blade to shoulder blade, held our skirts down with both hands. We pranced, we parried, we giggled and laughed. It was all good fun. We didn't understand when the boys began cornering us in the hallways, pulling our hair, grabbing our breasts. We said, "Stop, don't, no." When they didn't listen, we understood that they could take, without giving anything in return, what they wanted. We'd been lectured on how it was our duty to stay chaste, to be modest. We hid our blushing cheeks behind our hair, unrolled our skirts at the waistbands, pressed our knees into the pebbles, counting until it was our turn. Two. We brushed and curled her blonde hair, did her blue eyes up like a movie star. We loaned her our favorite blue jeans and misted her with perfume. In the light thrown off by the bonfire, his eyes were swimming holes. They were caves. The steep slope you could tumble down and down and down. We didn't know back then about the things a boy could say to get in between you and your idea of what it means to save yourself. We would have warned her if we could. But if we had been her, we wouldn't have listened either. We watched him lead her into the darkness beyond the tall grass. We listened to the dry stalks rustle in the wind. We wished we were her, or maybe we wished we were him. Three. She wonders how a captive body can be so free. Trembling on toe tip, hips waving, arms swinging like branches, fingers the flutter of bird wings. The body is tossed back and forth. Ragdoll, mannequin, puppet, she thinks. Head drops back on neck. Long blonde hair flops into the dirt. The body comes to rest under an autumn oak. The storm is arriving. She opens her eyes, curls onto her side, brings her knees up to her chest, and stays silently there, quietly clawing rocks out with bare hands. She clenches the two fullest in each fist. waiting for the rain to come, to pass. There is thunder. Lightning forks the yellow leaves. The tree, the dirt, her body are encased in golden light. She hears an electric sizzle, sees blind white. She feels a clicking, then a lightning, as she is delivered beyond the tree roots, beyond the mud, and into a free fall upwards past rain-soaked sky, into clear blue, the treetops far below. She unlocks her mouth, her hands. The stones fall to earth from her open palms. We remember darkness, how their eyes turned on us, how we danced under the stars. We danced so loudly in our tight jeans. We don't remember all of that night. We are mothers now, trying to forget how the boys each took a turn, how they held her arms, her legs. We rock our daughters and look down at the still faces, the closed eyes, think about the dreams they might be dreaming. We would kill to keep our daughters safe. We try to forget the way those hands looked clasped on wrists, on ankles, how the stones keep pressing into our knees. Oh, you guys can give me the hook when it's my time, because I have no concept of time when I'm reading whatsoever.
Maybe 10 more minutes.
10 more minutes? Okay. Sure. Cool. Thanks. Alright, I was looking for, I was trying to find a more fun piece. So this is called Magpie. I'd like to dedicate this to my husband Robert. So this is kind of his style that I borrowed a little bit. So maybe he'll read for us later. Yes, exactly. So this one is called Magpie. I'm a flimflam, a tin can, the garbage blowing along the alley. I'm jigsaw and hacksaw and bare teeth in the night, peeking out through the crack of your closet door. I'm chickadee and blue jay chirp, the sound you try to place in the floorboards creak, the fleck in your coffee that won't be caught, the blurred newsprint you keep trying to read. Maybe I'm you. But I'm always me. I'm crying as I'm laughing, pirouetting down the buckling sidewalks in my worn out black and white pop can top sequined shoes, jiggling and jingling, fingering the burnt edges of pancakes I keep in my pockets to pass out to the children who follow the sounds of me out through the gates of their fenced in manicured lawns, down, down, down the street, into the spray-painted cement, the pebbles glittering like jewels, the tadpole creek, all the trash shimmering in glorious piles. So this one is called Low in the Rain, and wrote this after Nabokov, so Lolita, and I was basically just having a lot of fun with language in this one. So it's called Low in the Rain. Ponytail, knee-socked, silk-pantied pleasure, my apocryphal, tumultuous Lolita, your rosy-cheeked complicity in the soiled charade is beautiful, voluptuous. Lips to lips, breast to breast, kneeling by the side of the wistful motel pool. Hear an amusing, moody agony in your ruffled, bow-trimmed bikini, chauffeuring me feelingless through these corporeal transactions. Dim light shines from underwater portholes, becomes shadowed loopholes for exploration, evocation, my sinking in to saturated blue-tinged delight. Breathless, shipwrecked, I rest my cheek on your peach fuzz thighs. The blood hums tenderly in my temples as picnickers in the distance are illuminated by lightning. This one is called There Is Shade in Our Eyes. We are waiting on the shore, trying to remember the sun to enjoy the water. Red algae shines in our cupped hands. We walk from safe sand banks toward the sound of silence. The echo is like a magnet, always calling, calling lovers to meet and follow any number of reasons to the ending. Our strut says, I do not know. Darkness pulls us closer to each other and to the moon lighting the path back down. Our mouths ask, where is the heat? The missiles are in the meeting of our lips. This is like fire, like drowning. As we tear apart, one of us seems to be running.
You know if you're looking for more of the bone.
Well, I know it could be misconstrued. Like, I'm trying to find something. So this one is called Birth Year. Look at the night sky, its vast display. Witness that this side of the world is black ink. It has become, without notice, the second year of the clock tick. After this present future, it may not brighten much. Take the dormant rows of wheat to keep this in mind, lest we forget and try later to go tumbling again toward a promised land. Look at the silo. It is a milestone, that empty metal cage. Realize we have the warmth of each other to hold in both hands. Skin yellowing by nightlight, both soft as melting wax, and the full moon settling in our laps. What do you think? One more?
Yes.
One?
Yeah.
Okay. I think
it's
there.
Sure, go ahead.
Okay. All right. So this is based on a fairy tale, as you can tell. So the three bears. One. Ursula wakes up late. Her parents have already caught breakfast and are sitting next to each other, their shiny coats sparkling with drops of water. She sits down, takes a piece of salmon. After eating, she daintily licks her claws. Her mother helps zip Ursula into her human suit. Her legs and arms tucked in become long and graceful. Her dark ursine eyes peek out beneath golden lashes. Ursula flips her hair, feels it cascade down the back of her red dress. As she is leaving, her mother says, mind your claws. Ursula holds up pink hands, wiggles her fingers in response. Her mother laughs. Watch for hunters, her father says. She smiles, nods her head, and does a twirl down the blackberry-lined lane. She knows her parents aren't yet used to the woman version of their little bear. Ursula walks out of the pines and into sunlight that reflects off her blonde head. Three bears splash in the nearby lake, tumbling the surface of the water. Hey, they call. She doesn't recognize them, keeps walking. Rude, says one. Didn't even smile, says the second. Let's teach her a lesson, says the third. Yeah, they snarl. The first bear leaps out in a roar of water. He growls, squats down on all fours in front of her. The other two amble up behind her until she is encircled by large bear bodies. They all grab her at once. Three. It is early evening as the bears arrive at their truck. Here, the bears unzip their suits, revealing pink skin. Human hands pass out cans of beer, which they gulp greedily, tossing empties to litter the road as they speed away. Later, they will return with guns to hunt the bears that killed a young girl.